What's cracking, big dogs? Welcome back to the channel. This is Bunk Bed Breakdowns, BDGE's very own dynasty show. And before I introduce Mike, I want to introduce my forehead to the channel.
Ah, look at the top of his head.
I don't think it's been out the entire time we've been doing this series. I always got the headband on. And as I was telling Mike before the show, today we got a lot of players to talk about. So what I lack in analysis, I got to make up for in looks that you guys can make fun of me in the comments. So I got the bun going. Mike's girlfriend popped on screen. She told me it looked beautiful. I beg to differ. I guess you guys in the comments will really let me know. That's enough rambling about this shitty-ass appearance I got going on. As always, I'm joined by Mike at Mike Me Up. I heard you had a fun time in Napa yesterday. How's your weekend been, man?
Dude, it was good, man. It was so hot in Napa, but we had a good time. Went to a couple wine tastings and whatnot. Look, I'm glad to have Lee Shang from Mulan on the show today. He's rocking a dope man bun. You're doing it good. You got some tips. I love that. Free Noah's forehead, guys. Free Noah's forehead. And hopefully we see more of this coming down the season.
Yeah, we'll see what happens in the comments. Depending on the feedback, we'll see if the forehead ever makes an appearance again. I know you guys have been stalking my LinkedIn to see a professional photo of me with my forehead out. So that might be the only chance you guys ever get after this point. But today's show, we're going to be doing some player dichotomies. This is probably the most redraft-focused episode we'll ever do. I'm not sure what we have in store next week, but we're looking at players that are very similar in redraft ADP, going one for one, players that have similar upside and similar floors, at least many people believe, and we might be debunking some of that. So also, if you guys want to get involved in redraft leagues through BDGE, sign up through our Patreon, patreon.com/BDGE. From there, you get access to our Discord, and in our Discord, you get access to private channels, the redraft league queues, where I'll be filling a few leagues. I think we are about three deep already, which is pretty solid. We've had a bunch of new Patreons, and on top of that, obviously, throughout the season, you get Nick's weekly ranks, you get his waiver wire piece, and you get access to private live streams and people in the Patreon answering your questions. It's all about the community. It's all about the big facts, and it's all about hitting that motherfucking intro.
Kicking off this week, we know it's redraft, it's a dynasty show, but it is redraft season, and even those of us that play dynasty still play in redraft leagues. I'm sure you're playing your home leagues with your homies and you want to dominate them, so we're bringing you the big ADP comparison, similar to what we did for dynasty, where we kind of looked at players that are in the same range. And you know, the way we pick these players is like we kind of try and pick guys within the same ADP, but like serve different purposes. And you'll kind of get to understand it a little bit more once we get more into it. But it'll be things like, you know, bounce back player versus up and comer, or like old guy versus young guy, or like, you know, someone that's gonna come in hot in the beginning of the season versus someone that comes in hot in the end of the season. So that's the theme for today. Starting it off with Nicky Snacks' favorite man in all of the NFL, Danny fucking Dimes, DJ, the new DJ. David Johnson, you relinquished that shit when you looked scared to run the football last season. So that nickname is gone. It's going to Daniel Jones. He's currently going at 56th overall in Superflex formats at the QB14. Again, all of these redraft ADPs are from Fantasy Mojo. They collect them from like paid FFPC leagues. So in my opinion, that's just the best type of data out there when it is paid. But Daniel Jones stacking up against last year's favorite, Noah's crowning achievement in forms of trade when he traded away this man, is Baker Mayfield. Came on really hot as a rookie. They basically had, you know, one of the more impressive rookie seasons we've seen in a while from an accuracy perspective. From a completion perspective, from basically every perspective you can think about from a metric standpoint. But he's currently, you know, suffered a little bit from a fall of grace. You know, he fell to basically overall 58th to QB 15. So they're kind of going back to back now. Now, these are two prospects that were, you know, I would say couldn't have been more different. You know, Baker Mayfield's a 101, you know, everyone kind of loved him, especially from the analytics side. And Daniel Jones was like the laughing stock. You know, when the Giants made that pick, everyone was laughing. Snacks was crying. It was just a complete dichotomy. And, you know, a year later, here we are, like this unpredictable game, pinning them back to back. For me, it really depends on the format and the scoring. But Noah, which one of these guys are you taking in redraft this year?
Yeah, for me, this is me very similar to next year when it's Kyler Murray versus Justin Herbert. Like, we're all laughing now, but we'll see what happens. For me personally, this is kind of a cop-out because he is going higher in ADP, and I usually like to go with the underdog, but Baker's been seen as an underdog basically his entire career, but he has like fucking 10 Pro Bowlers helping him out and he still can't do shit. I'm going with Daniel Jones here because what we saw out of Daniel Jones in his rookie year, thrown into the fire behind a mediocre offensive line with a bunch of weapons that couldn't stay healthy all season, was a higher peak than what Baker Mayfield even reached in his rookie year. Baker only put up 19.3 fantasy points per game as a rookie. Daniel Jones was at 19.8, and that's despite all the turnovers he had. And sure, you know, second year for a rookie heading into a second year might not be as easy because there's obviously more film for different defensive schemes and defensive coordinators to look into to find out more about his game. I'd argue that they knew enough about his game last year, basically just smacked the ball right out of his hand. He's going to drop it half the time. But what I saw out of Daniel Jones that I really like, and it's the added floor that he gives you that Baker Mayfield doesn't add. It's the rushing game upside. Now, Baker Mayfield did have more rushing touchdowns last year, but that's a little bit more fluky than when you look at the rushing attempts and the rushing yards. Daniel Jones is averaging over 21 rushing yards per game last year, whereas Baker was about 8 rushing yards per game. When you look at his passing upside, sure, you can argue that Baker Mayfield is probably going to throw for more touchdowns this season. But when you take into consideration that Daniel Jones giving you 20 to 25 or however many rushing yards per game you want to project, that's basically an additional half touchdown per game. So that's like, what, another 8 passing touchdowns worth of rushing volume. I guess when you compare Baker to Daniel Jones, it's about 4 because like 10 to 20 per game, whatever. He gives you about 4 additional passing touchdowns worth of value through his rushing yardage that Baker Mayfield doesn't add to you. So although Baker might have the ceiling to throw 30 to 35 touchdowns through the air, if Daniel Jones has 28 touchdowns through the air, which might be a little bit of a spicy take, his ability on the ground will make up for that. And obviously the rushing touchdowns will probably come off the back of that. And looking at redraft and comparing the situations for this year, I already kind of mentioned that Daniel Jones wasn't in the best situation last year. Like, he does have a bunch of talented players in Darius Slayton, Sterling Shepard, Golden Tate, Evan Ingram, Saquon Barkley. None of those guys played a full season last year. So as long as they stay healthy and as long as they're fully implemented into the offense, he should have plenty of mouths to feed and a bunch of guys that occupy different areas of the field, whether it's Darius Slayton deep or Shepard and Tate over the middle and Saquon Barkley out of the backfield and Evan Ingram up the seam. So I do like his slate of weapons, but it'd also be kind of disingenuous to not say like Baker Mayfield was put in a bad situation as well with Freddie Kitchens, with Odell playing with, I think it's like a sports hernia they're talking about, Jarvis Landry having or not having, whatever happened to his hip. His hip wasn't great all season. They bring in Austin Hooper. Kareem Hunt for a full season is now there. So both teams look to be bouncing back with new OCs, basically new offensive systems, and a bunch of supporting cast that they weren't subjected to last year. But just looking at what Daniel Jones did in the face of a terrible situation, the ability that he has to create points for himself on the ground is what makes me lean Daniel Jones over Baker Mayfield. And, you know, betting on Daniel Jones over Baker Mayfield, it doesn't sound smart because Daniel Jones isn't the best real-life quarterback. But when it comes down to fantasy, I'm not always going for the better player. I'm still going to draft, or at least last year, you would have been much happier having a Mark Ingram than a Joe Mixon on your team. And I don't think anybody's arguing that Joe Mixon is a worse football player than Mark Ingram. So when it comes down to it, I'll just take the ceiling that Daniel Jones gives you by way of the air game and then the floor he also provides because what he can rush for you on the ground week after week.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of in your boat, especially when it comes to redraft. I think in Dynasty, it's a bit of a tougher decision. But look, in redraft, they at least address the O-line, right? I mean, that was the first thing they did was address the O-line, which is super helpful for him because, you know, it turns out Daniel Jones has a legitimate, like an actual blind side where he literally does not see pass rushers. He does the
bird box challenge every time he drops back, Mike.
He has eyes no closed, sense.
Pray for the best.
He has no sense. But in terms of a ceiling play, he's definitely got it. I mean, look at his scoring, right? The problem with Daniel Jones is like, and the reason why I say it depends on scoring is because like, if you play in like a 6 touchdown, -4 interception, like -2 fumble league, which is like usually what I'm in, he can really sink your week. So Baker might not have the ceiling that he has, but I think Baker with this more improved O-line is actually a better passer and might give you that floor. And in Superflex, you kind of want floors from your quarterback. You don't want guys scoring you like -6 points or like 3 points. And if you look at Daniel Jones, let's see, he scored below 8 points in your conventional league like three times last year. He scored like 5 points one game, 7.4 points one game, 7.2 points one game. And then he'll go off for like 34. So Daniel Jones is like a matchup play, right? So you don't, I don't really feel too comfortable if he's my QB2 that I have to start every single week. But if I can draft him as like a QB3, you know, someone that I can kind of rotate through my thing, I would really like that because he does provide you a lot of ceiling and it comes from the Konami code. I mean, if this was single quarterback, I'm all for drafting Daniel Jones, but probably not not starting him in the first 3 weeks because if you look at his opening schedule, the Giants are going up against the Steelers. So open up against the Steelers, one of the best defenses in the league, both from a passing and rushing perspective. And then you got the Bears, regardless, even though they sucked last year, they're getting Akeem Hicks back this year. So it should be a lot better. And then they still got Khalil Mack on the outside. And we just talked about Daniel Jones' blind side. And then you got the 49ers. You got Nick Bosa coming in from the blind side as well. So you know he's like, it's a almost virtual guarantee that he's going to fumble the ball in those games. You just got to hope that he kind of comes back and gets some garbage time touchdowns, which is not really what you're hoping for. So I would fade Daniel Jones to start the season, which kind of makes me like iffy about, you know, whether or not I really want to draft him and invest like a mid QB2 QB2 price, because if you can't really start him for the first three games, it's a bit tough, right? So I think from that perspective, it's a little bit risky for me. But in terms of like ceiling, definitely there, because once you get to the middle of the part of the season, he's playing against like Washington, Bucks. You know, these are the fantasy juicy matchups that you want, and he can definitely win you the week. And I think he's got way higher of a ceiling than Baker has. So it really comes down to team construction. So really think about that when you're building it, and if you can afford to kind of have him in that QB3 rotation slot.
Yeah, he looks like a good buy low candidate because, as you said, when he's in the meat of the season, he has good matchups. And also remember, he's in the NFC East, and basically two out of those three teams that they play are pass funnels because the Dallas Cowboys have a really strong interior, but the secondary is a little bit weaker. Same with Philadelphia. And then the Washington football team, despite having a super long name and sounding real professional, are absolute buns. So that's six games a year. He should be doing very, very well, as opposed to Baker Mayfield, who has to go up against the aforementioned Pittsburgh Steelers and the Baltimore Ravens. The Bengals, they're probably going to tear them apart. But as far as the other two teams go, those four matchups are probably going to be pretty tough. So maybe draft Baker Mayfield and flip him for Daniel Jones. Don't say that I told you to do that, because that's probably not a great strategy, but it looks to be, after Daniel Jones has that tough start, it looks to be a pretty easy buy because people are not going to want a guy who has eight turnovers through the first 3 weeks of the season.
Yep. So that's that. And the next one, another quarterback battle, two of the big dogs' favorites. Actually, I mean, I guess Ryan Tannehill is one of my favorites. I don't know if it's you guys' favorite, but Ryan Tannehill versus Gardner Minshew. Ryan Tannehill currently going as a 79th overall pick at QB 21, which is just blatant fucking disrespect. It cannot happen any longer. This is like the A-Rob of quarterbacks, in my opinion. And then you got Gardner Minshew going at quarterback 22, also very undervalued. So we've kind of talked about it. You know, Gardner Minshew, he's got questions in Dynasty, whatever, but we're talking about redraft right now. And, you know, we like both these guys in both formats. So I love Ryan Tannehill in Dynasty. I'm taking him everywhere. Love Gardner Minshew in Dynasty, taking him everywhere. But in redraft, it just really comes down to this year. Like, what do you believe, right? And for me, like, I think I would rather have Ryan Tannehill, because if you look at them, they both actually have pretty good rushing floors. And I don't know if you know this, Noah, but fun fact, Ryan Tannehill played wide receiver in college. So that's kind of
weird. Wait, did Antonio Gates play basketball in college?
Yeah.
Oh, how about Jimmy Graham?
Yeah.
Oh, I've never heard of those. I brought them up.
Yeah. So that's where he kind of gets a little bit of that swagger, that wiggle from. He can make plays with the ball in his hands, and he's a tough son of a bee. So I really love Ryan Tannehill, and I know people are going to really hang on the fact that, like, look, the Titans are a run-first team, runs through King Henry, whatever, whatever. And I'm just going to go back to that stat that I told you guys about, which is, like, in the past little while, 12 out of 13 teams who passed for under 500 attempts increased their pass attempts the following year. And they increased it on average by 60 attempts. So I genuinely do not think the Titans are going to be able to run the way that they did last season. They lost a key piece on the O-line. I think there's going to be more rushing volume coming in. And, you know, Tannehill was – honestly, he was one of the best performing quarterbacks for the second half of the season in terms of, like, efficiency metrics, completion percentage over expectation, like, EPA, like, everything that mattered. Like, when that offense shifted is when Ryan Tannehill came in. So he's not a bum. He was never a bum even when he was playing with Gase. He was just hurt. So now that he's healthy, he's got his contract. Like, I'm deep, deep, deep into buying in on Ryan Tannehill. And I think you guys should be too. And it's a tough toss up between the two because they both kind of have similar things, right? They both have rushing floor, except one's on a really good offense and one's on a really bad offense. So I'm going to pass off to you here, Wick. Which one are you taking?
Man, Mike, you put me in a real tough spot. I didn't even see this dichotomy until right now. I'm going to be honest with you guys, and this definitely does not help the viewers. You could have put Patrick Mahomes against Gardner Minshew, and I'm rolling with Gardner every day. I love this guy so much. The thing is, like, if you're going to fade quarterback, what better 1-2 punch is there than Ryan Tannehill and Gardner Minshew? You basically get young Tannehill with the sex drive and the sex factor, and then you get Ryan Tannehill, who's a little bit more vanilla. But both of them are just going to give you a solid floor through the rushing game. Ryan Tannehill, volume-wise, I know you said it's probably going to increase, but I would argue, you know, Gardner Minshew is obviously going to be throwing the ball a little bit more this year because the Jacksonville defense is terrible. The front office basically went up to the nearest vending machine, threw A.J. Boye, threw Calais Campbell into the slot, and got a bag of chips in return. They have absolutely nothing on the defensive side of the ball. Their offensive line is still pretty garbage. They could have drafted a million guys in the draft, and I don't think that they're going to patch any holes there. But being a little bit more serious, between these two guys, I'm probably going to go with I'll go with Gardner Minshew here. I just think that there's going to be so much volume in this offense. The fact that they can't run the ball efficiently at all. Like, you can argue with me that Leonard Fournette is a good running back. I don't give a damn. I'm not going to listen to any of those arguments. If they want to use him out of the backfield as a receiver, and that's why you're drafting him, good. That helps the argument for Gardner Minshew, because I don't see how he's going to be a 300-touch guy solely on the ground this season, especially behind that offensive line that I already mentioned. The fact that they bring in Laviska Shenault into this offense and Chris Thompson for whatever's left of him, it just seems like they're surrounding him with weapons to see what he has in his bag, to see if they need to spend, you know, the first, second, or third, whatever pick they end up being next year on a quarterback. So I think they gave Gardner Minshew all the options and all the players and all the talent surrounding him that he needs to prove that he is a solid football player. And despite not having that type of that caliber of weapon group around him last year, being surrounded by Chris Conley, DeeDee Westbrook, DJ Chark is very good, but the other guys are very mediocre in replacement level. He was still giving you basically like 16 to 18 fantasy points per week, week in and week out. He got replaced. They realized Nick Foles is a fraud. He got his job back, and he kind of had a tough go at it at the second half of the season. But when you look at a situation this year, there's really nobody forcing his hand. He's the only guy in Jacksonville that's going to be throwing the ball this season. He already beat his COVID case. He basically said COVID is afraid of him. So if COVID is confident in this guy's talent, I kind of have to be too. This is no slight at Ryan Tannehill. I still think he's a very good quarterback, and he does give you the rushing upside as well. I just think that if there's one team to break the mold of continuing to be a low-volume passing offense, it's probably one with Derrick Henry there. He's killed me way too many times for me to doubt him at this point. So I'm going to lean Gardner Minshew, but I think both these guys at their price being, you know, 81st and 79th off the board respectively, honestly, go for both of them. If you're like at a turn somewhere or wherever these picks end up lining up, just grab both of them, have a good QB2, QB3 combo.
Yeah, I mean, the volume, it's an interesting question, right? Because Gardner Minshew, without a doubt, is going to have more volume passing. But I would say, you know, Ryan Tannehill will have more volume than last year, in my opinion, but he'll also have, like, better volume, like higher quality volume, because that offense is going to be moving down the field. Titans is top three, I think, in easiest strength of schedule. So, you know, they're going to be scoring a lot, which honestly plays in the favor of Henry, because they can probably keep the running game going if they're playing against weak opponents. But at the same time, Ryan Tannehill can also be, you know, has a chance of maintaining that level of efficiency, or at least not having like a dramatic fall off from an efficiency perspective.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, they did that last year too. They pounded the rock with Derrick Henry, and Ryan Tannehill is still like the QB2 down the stretch. So it's possible to happen. It's unlikely, but it can definitely happen. He definitely has the upside of a quarterback one.
Yeah, I mean, his floor is pretty incredible. I mean, he scored below 17 points in one game, and he had multiple games of like 20 plus points. So both guys are good. Like Noah said, if you're at the turn, hammer him. But personally, I'm going to go with my guy, Ryan Tannehill, and redraft and dynasty, whatever. I think he's easily the most undervalued quarterback right now in fantasy. And you should be getting him wherever you can. Just like wherever you can, freaking draft him. Because I promise you, this guy, he's not going to be Lamar Jackson. Nobody's going to be Lamar Jackson. If anyone tells you that there's another Lamar Jackson, ask them for the hookup for the weed, because they are incredibly high out of their minds. But Ryan Tannehill is like this year's late round quarterback winner, I think, you know, in any format, super flex, you know, single quarterback, I don't care, whatever. Just make sure you get your hands on him. And Gardner Minshew is definitely up there as well. So that wraps up the quarterbacks. Next up, go to our most fun position. And we're going to kick it off with a pretty interesting one, right? We're going to start with DeAndre Swift versus Kareem Hunt and Swift. You know, obviously the knock on him is the landing spot. We all said it, but the talent is undeniable. We loved him at Big Dogs before the draft. Honestly, I still really like him in Dynasty. I've been getting a little bit more exposure to him recently. But in redraft, he's going at 63rd overall. So in the sixth round, top of the sixth round, at RB24. And right behind him, one pick behind him, is Kareem Hunt at RB25. So this is, again, it's an interesting dichotomy because DeAndre Swift is someone that's, you know, going into a committee, most likely, on a, you know, a mediocre to slightly above average offense, call it. We're not sure what his role is. Probably some form of, like, rookie Kerryon Johnson, except he's a lot better. And then you got Kareem Hunt, who, like, is a very diverse spectrum of things, right? Like, some people think he's going to be the receiving back and eat up all of Chubb's receptions. Some people think he's going to eat up into the carries. Some people think he's going to be, you know, split goal line touches. Some people think he's going to be nothing because Nick Chubb's elite, you know? So there's a wide range of stuff here. And one, they're both in, you know, I'm not gonna call it committee because I think Chubb's going to easily win that job. Like, he's the future of that franchise, in my opinion. But they're both in some murky backfields, a lot of question marks, right? And I think when it comes to redraft for me, like, I'm going to go with DeAndre Swift more often than not, because I'm going to bet on DeAndre Swift beating out Kerryon Johnson before I bet on Kareem Hunt beating out Nick Chubb, who's, by my estimation, the best pure runner in the NFL today. And DeAndre Swift does whatever Kerryon Johnson does, except he does it better. You know, whether it's pass pro, whether it's running the ball, whether it's receiving the ball, like, everything Kerryon Johnson does, DeAndre Swift can do, but better. So it's kind of just like that old commercial back in the day, like, anything you can do, like, I can do better. I think it was a Nike commercial. That's DeAndre Swift. So I'm going to bet on that guy because at least I think he's going to give you starter weeks, like, right out the gate, in my opinion. Like, what do you think about this, Noah?
Yeah, I was super high, and I'm still pretty high in Kareem Hunt. For a long time, just looking at, you know, how good he is on the goal line, how good of a pass catcher he is, Stefanski coming in. And then I started to realize, I think I'm starting to look too deep into this situation. I'm trying to be way too optimistic about Kareem Hunt as a pass catcher, as a goal line back, as a between the 20s runner. Because for as good as Kareem Hunt is and as good as he looked last season, Nick Chubb is still the better pure runner. Despite how good he's been on the goal line, his goal line conversion rate is 61.1%. So basically 6 out of 10 times he gets a carry inside the 5, it's going for 6. Nick Chubb, on the other hand, is 31.8%. The thing is, though, despite being that much better throughout his entire career, and despite Nick Chubb being as bad as he was last year, Kareem Hunt commanded one goal line carry last year. So maybe Freddie Kitchens is just that big of an idiot, and maybe Stefanski realizes the fault and the stars there, and he makes Kareem Hunt the goal line back. But I don't know. Something just tells me Nick Chubb is still going to be the guy. No shot what? That Kareem Hunt becomes the guy in the goal line?
No fucking shot. There's no shot.
That's the thing. Like, you have to be super confident that he overcomes basically everything that happened last year and puts up the numbers that he did down the stretch. On top of that, he was on pace for 74 receptions last year, which is fantastic. But you also have to realize that they bring in Austin Hooper into town. And Austin Hooper is basically a fullback. His ADOT is 6.5 yards, which is despicable. And I know you want to say, oh, well, talent wins out and talent wins targets, whatever. Austin Hooper's still decent. He's decent after the catch, was surprising to me, looking at his yards after catch per reception and per target. He was pretty efficient last year, and despite being a volume play, he did make some breakaway plays. So although Kareem Hunt was on pace for like 88 targets and 74 receptions, I do think the addition of Austin Hooper is just another mouth to feed in that offense, another mouth that has proven it is one that deserves being fed. So that only chips away at his receiving upside as well. And on top of that, Stefanski, we think that this offense is going to be ground and pound. But why would they pay Austin Hooper all this money to be as ground and pound as we expect them to be? Why is Odell still in town? Why is Jarvis still there? So there's a lot going into it that makes me want to lean DeAndre Swift, and that's where I'm going to go with this, because on the flip side, DeAndre Swift just has to outplay Kerryon Johnson. And Kerryon Johnson can't even outplay Kerryon Johnson. That dude's a fucking fraud. He can't stay on the field. He can't stay healthy. And when he's on the field and being healthy and given a bunch of touches, he's extremely inefficient. And if you look over the first 5 games last season before he got injured, I think the 6th game he left early, so I didn't count it, he was averaging 19.2 touches per game and played 70% of the snaps in 3 out of 5 of those games. So I'm not saying DeAndre Swift is a lock for 20 touches or 70 snap share back, but I do think that even if it is a timeshare, he can work his way well into 12 to 15 carries off the bat, maybe work his way into like 17, 18, not carries, but total touches, and a good portion of those coming through the air, because we've seen Matt Stafford not be afraid to dump off the ball. He's not the most mobile guy out there, especially with all his vertebrae basically fused together like Tiger Woods is. He's going to have to dump the ball off a lot. And what better way to do it than dump it off to your second round pick in DeAndre Swift, who is absolutely electric at Georgia at running back U. And as you said, he outclasses Kerryon Johnson in every aspect of the field. Whereas Kareem Hunt being compared to Nick Chubb, there's other than passing game, the passing down work and maybe the goal line work, which I'm not even convinced Kareem Hunt is going to overtake. There isn't much you can be in favor of Kareem Hunt for. And yes, I know Nick brings it up a lot and everybody brings it up. If Nick Chubb gets hurt, Kareem Hunt's a top five back. Fuck you. Fuck you for saying that. Because if anybody gets hurt, the other guy's going to be a top five back. If Dalvin Cook gets hurt, Alexander Madison's like a top seven back. You're not drafting Alexander Madison in the seventh round. What you are drafting is DeAndre Swift in the fourth or fifth round because he is and was coming into this class a top two talent at the running back position. And although he's been put in a poor situation looking from the outside in, I think Daryl Bevell will realize that he has somewhat of a workhorse back and use him. Not exactly how he used AP and Marshawn Lynch, but a lot closer to that usage than what Kerryon Johnson was expecting to get heading into last year. So the final verdict for me is go DeAndre Swift and just reap the rewards. And this isn't to say that Kareem Hunt is a poor pick. I still really do like him, and I think he's being picked around his floor. But I don't think his ceiling is as high as DeAndre Swift, and you're not choosing your RB26 or RB25, whatever he is, to be an RB25 on the season. You want him to end up having top 12 upside. I think DeAndre Swift gives you just that.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the only way Hunt gets there is if Chubb gets injured, to be honest. And I think that, you know, I like him too. And, you know, I traded from in a league, but it's just, I think the hype is getting a little bit out of control when you have DeAndre Swift, who is the, in my opinion, the clear lead running back for Detroit Lions. He might be in a committee, but he's going to lead it. And just like Kerryon Johnson, his rookie year, he's going to give you RB2 numbers. I mean, I don't think he's going to give you like RB1 out of the gate. He might, but he's going to give you RB2 numbers. So when you draft him there, you're going to be able to put him in your lineup, and he's going to give you points, which is pretty important. I don't know if I have that with Kareem Hunt, at least yet. And, you know, before we hop in the next one, I just want to take a quick break to entertain some people because I just read the dumbest fucking thing I've ever seen on Twitter.
You got to send it to me so I can throw it up on the screen.
Yeah, I'll send it to you. But it's at Elliot Shore Parks. I mean, this dude looks like he's an extra from The Office that didn't make it, but he says he basically tweeted about, you know, like what's most likely to happen. He says, I could maybe score a touchdown. I could luck into a home run, as in the MLB. I could probably get 2 points in the NBA. I could play hundreds of games of hockey and never, ever score a goal. It looks impossible. Look, granted, all those things are incredibly unlikely, but the fact that you think you could probably get 2 points in the NBA is a fucking joke, dude. Like, you would not even you think you can get 2 points in the NBA is hilarious to me. That's one. But the fact that you think you can luck into a home run, like, look, I hate watching baseball because I think it's boring as fuck, but it is one of the most technical sports around. Like, it's probably one of the hardest things to do. Like, if someone threw a 95-hour fastball towards me, like, I would be lucky if I could if I even saw the ball. Never mind hit a
It's not even that. You know how fast, like, 85 looks? If somebody throws you an 85-mile-an-hour curveball, you're ducking and you're getting out of there, and the ball is right down the pipe, and you're not touching that ball at all.
There's, yeah, dude.
That guy's blasphemous. He's dumber than me when I slander Derrick Henry.
Dude, I played some ball. I played some baseball when I was younger, and like, I think kids in those days were throwing like, you know, like 50 something, right? Like 60 miles per hour. And like, dude, like that was like beast. And I was like, holy shit, like, I can't believe this kid can throw that fast. Like 95, like being two times faster than that. Like, are you fucking out of your mind? You think not only would you not even make contact with the ball ever, like I could bet like probably someone would throw, you know, 50 balls and maybe you luck into like contact on one of them. Maybe. But the fact that you can hit it out of the park with a home run via luck, like the lack, oh man, I got to fucking retweet.
Absolute animal. Take of the week by Elliot Shorehouse, whatever his name was.
Elliot Shore Parks, fucking clown take of the week. Like, Jesus Christ. All right, back to the big facts. Just had to provide some entertainment because, like, I mean, normally I don't interrupt the content, but that was just one of the worst and dumbest.
You kind of had to with that. I mean, you can't say you're going to hit a home run off an MLB pitcher, but you can maybe not score a goal in hockey. Like, what does that type of take?
Oh, my God. Okay, anyways, that guy's in it. All right, so next up, we got a couple of old guns, okay? We got Todd Gurley in his new slick Atlanta uniform. I know everyone loves the visor, and you got to move your ranks up because you saw that. But you got him at pick 31, RB16 versus Noah's favorite player of all time, Melvin Gordon. I guess second favorite now that Justin Herbert's been drafted. But Melvin.
All right, Mike, chill out.
Gordon, Melvin Gordon at 35th overall, RB17. Again, these guys are going back to back. Not back to back, but pretty close to each other within the third round. Look, if it were up to me, I think you put this one on here, but I'm fading both of them because I don't really touch running backs in that, because that's known as the RB dead zone. I mean, running backs are just don't really perform that well, especially some of the older ones, I think. But if I were to pick, I think I'm going to go with Melvin Gordon here. And the reason why is because, like, you already saw some reports, like Todd Gurley is already getting limited because his knee is basically on that last strand, like whatever that little strand of meat is that like holds meat together, like it's literally looking like dental floss right now. Okay. Cause that's where he's at. And then you got Melvin Gordon, he's a proven workhorse. And despite the injury prone negative, the narrative that floats around, like he's actually played like a decent amount of games, even when he's hurt, he plays. And I think he's going to get some volume there on Denver. But you know, Phillip Lindsay is definitely gonna steal some touches, but at the same time, like Phillip Lindsay is no goal line back. So we know that Melvin Gordon is going to be that guy. And if that Denver offense does elevate to the degree that everyone thinks they will under Drew Lock, because of all the weapons they've taken, Melvin Gordon's going to be in store for a lot of work. And Lindsay is not a receiver at all. So he's basically got that part locked up. Royce Freeman might not even make it onto the roster. So look, I think both guys are in store for some volume, but I think the injury concerns are a little bit more there for Todd Gurley. And that offensive line is awful. And we just honestly, like, we've seen Todd Gurley behind a bad offensive line. And this is not a slight to Gurley, because I'm sure he's a pretty talented guy, obviously. But his style, like, he's not the most elusive guy, right? He's not going to juke you out in the backfield. So, like, him behind an inefficient O-line with that knee kind of scares me a little bit. So that's why I'm going with Melvin Gordon personally. What do you think?
Yeah, I'm actually pretty high on Melvin Gordon this season. I just think the one time he's been good in his entire career efficiency-wise, because he has scored a bunch of touchdowns outside of his rookie year, but the one time he was good efficiency-wise was 2018 on the Chargers, because that was the only time they've had a competent offensive line. I believe they were sixth in adjusted line yards that year, and he was the RB2 on a point-per-game basis before getting injured, and he was the RB3 for the full season on a point-per-game basis behind like Saquon Barkley and Todd Gurley. And just looking at the situation he's in now, although he's probably going to split carries with Phillip Lindsay, we got to remember he's also split touches with Austin Eckler in the past two seasons. He's been very, not efficient, but he's been very productive in spite of that. And with the offensive line that they have, which ranked 11th in adjusted line yards last season, and replacing Ronald Leary, who had a 52.6 run blocking grade per PFF, with Graham Glasgow at 74.2, it's a big bump up. It was basically a top 10 guard run blocking wise for a bottom 10 guard. They can only go up from there. And even if they stay at the 11th ranked offensive line, they're still like upper half of the league, well within the upper half of the league. And I think Melvin Gordon is going to be able to do very well behind that offensive line. And on top of that, you hit the nail on the head. Phillip Lindsay isn't a pass catcher. Guess who else isn't a pass catcher? Royce Freeman. He saw 50 targets last year, despite being a fat little turd that can't do much with the ball in his hands. Melvin Gordon is kind of a fat turd, but he can at least do a little bit with the ball in his hands. So I see his floor anywhere from like 50 to 60 targets. And I think his ceiling could be well within like the 65 to 70 target range. As for Todd Gurley, it could be very, very similar, because Devonta Freeman saw 70 targets last season, was extremely inefficient. And since Atlanta throws the ball so much, they have to give it to somebody. And I guess Todd Gurley is going to be a beneficiary of that. But as you said, we saw what he did behind an inefficient offensive line last year. He found his way to the end zone 14 times, with the longest run or the longest play getting him into the end zone being 13 yards. The fact that Atlanta's offensive line is as bad as it is, and as they're as pass heavy as they are, and with a bunch of more athletic and explosive playmakers in comparison to Todd Gurley, whether it be Julio Jones or Calvin Ridley or whatever Twitter thinks Hayden Hurst is, I don't see his touchdown upside being double digits. Whereas Melvin Gordon, basically the past four seasons, has been at or around double digit touchdowns, and staying in division behind a better offensive line in a better situation with a revamped offense, I don't see his floor being much further below like 8 to 9 scores this year. So I'm sticking with Melvin Gordon on this one. They just seem like very similar players, but one is in a much more obviously better situation than the other. So I'll go with the cheaper price in Melvin Gordon and let both of them put their second foot in the grave heading into next season.
Yeah. Yeah. Look, I mean, up to me, I'm fading them both because for wide receivers, but if I had to pick, definitely go on the Melvin Gordon side. Let's see if we can get some disagreements going, other than the Ryan Tannehill and Gardner Minshew. That's definitely boring when you could just kind of copy everything I say and just go. I'm kidding. All right. Next
up. I'm never going to go on my boy Melvin Gordon.
Next up. This is an interesting one. Again, comes to that dichotomy. We got J.K. Dobbins All right. We talked about him as a potential league winner in both redraft and dynasty, but he specifically in redraft, given his ADP, he's currently going as the overall pick 82 RB30. So an RB3, a mid-round RB3 versus Ronald Jones, the ever polarizing player, the off-season bulker, the off-season weightlifter, constantly putting on pounds in the off-season to get himself yoked. He is currently going as the overall 87th pick, so just a few picks after Dobbins, as the RB31. So back-to-back and positional, a few picks apart. And I picked this one because I think it'd be interesting, right? Like J.K. Dobbins, we know unless Ingram gets hurt in training, J.K. Dobbins is probably not going to be a lead role, out the gate at least, right? And Ronald Jones, on the flip hand, like, we know that he's going to be the guy. Like, they've said it. The coaches have said it. Vaughn definitely is not it, at least to start. So they basically came out and said, look, it's Rojo's job. He's going to be the first and second down back and maybe get some third down passing work as well. But the reason why I wanted to choose this is because one guy is for sure going to give you some work early on. We don't know how high that ceiling is. I don't think it's that high because I think it's going to be a committee no matter what. Versus someone like J.K. Dobbins, where he's kind of like a Kareem Hunt scenario, where like if that lead dog goes down in Mark Ingram, or if he beats him out, you're looking at, in my opinion, a league winner. So just given the amount of volume they run, just given the strength of schedule, we've talked about all the factors before, but if J.K. Dobbins secures a lead role in that offense, like, he is going to be a top five running back because of how much they run, how much they score, and how good that offense is. Whereas like Rojo, like, even if people get hurt behind him, I just don't really see him with top five upside. Granted, look, I love Brady. I love Gronk. I'm a Patriots fan. But, like, I just don't see that offense going to the same level as the Baltimore Ravens. So this is kind of like a scenario where, like, are you looking to take that security blanket in the first part of the season, or are you trying to swing for the fences later on? And, you know, based on how I phrase that, I think you're going to know my answer. Like, I'm going with J.K. Dobbins. I've said he's the league winner. I'm going to try and get him at every single redraft league that I can, because I think there's a chance with COVID and everything that's happening. Like, there's so much variance, so much uncertainty. We don't know if Ingram's 30-year-old body's in the last. He already got hurt last year at the end of the season. We don't know, like, how much Baltimore's going to be dominating again, right? Like, they have a really easy schedule. And if they're dominating, they're going to want to see what they got in their second-round pick, right? So there's a chance that they kind of save Ingram for the playoffs and then get Dobbins out there for more touches. So I think there's just a lot of variance, a lot of scenarios I can see playing out that goes in Dobbins' favor. And I'm in this range. I'm swinging for upside. And I just don't think Rojo has league winning upside, whereas I think J.K. Dobbins absolutely does. And that's why I'm going with him with my pick.
Yeah. You wanted some disagreements, Mike. You're going to find none here. I think it's well known that I'm not the biggest Ronald Jones fan. He's starting to teeter onto that fat running back scale where he's about 230 pounds, which for me isn't a good thing because my hit rate on fat running backs is extremely poor. So maybe he's going to prove me wrong, but I think you just covered everything. We talked about J.K. Dobbins a few weeks ago, maybe it was last week, just the league-winning upside that he has, because not only is he a good running back, but he found himself in a situation that was very similar to what he saw in his freshman and junior year at Ohio State with the mobile quarterback. So, you know, we already talked about all that. We do think that he is a very high upside type of running back, whereas Ronald Jones, you could say he's a high upside guy because he had that 1 week with like 8 catches and he had a few good games here and there. But what worries me about him is he going to have the passing down work? Like, obviously J.K. Dobbins isn't, but that's not why you're drafting him. You're drafting him because he's part of a very good running offense. But Ronald Jones, is he going to get all the between the 20s work? Like, he was splitting that work with Peyton fucking Barber last year, who stinks. Is he going to get all the goal line work, which he was splitting with Peyton Barber last year as well? So there's just a lot up in the air, and the valuable touches that he is set to see aren't being guaranteed, whereas we know if Mark Ingram goes down, and maybe even if he doesn't go down and they just want to rest him towards the second half of the season, J.K. Dobbins is going to be in line for a ton of work, a ton of valuable touches in a very high scoring offense. And just the fact that Tampa Bay passes as often as they do, and they pass very often in the red zone as well, leads me to believe that Ronald Jones doesn't have the upside, not nearly the upside that J.K. Dobbins would have if Mark Ingram were to go down, but just overall, I don't think he has top 12 upside no matter what happens, because as you said, like, they do have a lot of running backs in this stable, whether it be Keyshawn Vaughn or Darryl Ogunbowale or LeSean McCoy, who they decided to bring in. Like, that just tells me that they don't have a ton of confidence in having one workhorse back in that stable right now. So I'd just rather go with the upside at this price, like RB30, RB31. I'm not drafting these guys hoping I get the RB20 on the season. I'm drafting them hoping that they're going to win me my league. And I just don't see that type of upside with Ronald Jones that I do with J.K. Dobbins.
Yeah, I mean, like, you're not trying to look for, like, seasonal finishes. Like, I have no doubts that Rojo will finish the season with more points than J.K. Dobbins, right? I actually think that's very likely. But what I care about is, like, in that final stretch or in those final 6 weeks, 7 weeks, who's giving me, like, a points per game that's actually making a difference. So that's why I like J.K. Dobbins, because, like, if Ingram goes down or, like, if whatever all these scenarios that we talked about playing out, like, he could be a guy that's giving you, like, 18, like, points per game, right? Like a Derrick Henry type of upside. And that's something that's really appealing to me in those later rounds. And look, no slight to Rojo. I've actually, like, you know, turned the corner with him. Like, I used to not really like him at all. But honestly, last year he improved a lot. And, you know, he's getting all the steam and all the praise from the coaches. So we kind of have to buy that he is the guy until he's not the guy. But I just don't like that backfield right now. And so if I'm going to bet on upside, it's definitely going to be J.K. Dobbins. All right. So that wraps up the running backs. Next up, I'm going to get into some wide receivers, some sexy, sexy wide receivers. Too bad Nick's not here because we want to talk about his mans. We got Tyler Lockett versus Terry McLaurin. And the reason why I chose these two guys is not just because both their names start with a T. It's because Tyler Lockett and Terry McLaurin play on very different offenses. And they're going to score very differently, right? Tyler Lockett, Russell Wilson to Tyler Lockett is one of the most efficient and actually, no, it is like the most efficient combinations that we've seen maybe ever. And I don't know if that's because Russell Wilson is that good, probably, or if it's because Tyler Lockett is also a baller, also probably true. But that connection is insane. And before Tyler Lockett got hurt last season, he was on route to be a top five wide receiver, right? And that's on limited volume. And one thing is, I don't think that limited volume is going to stay. Like, the Seattle defense is not what it used to be, although they did just add the president, which is going to be huge for them. I still think they're going to be a higher volume passing offense than, like, the days of, like, the old days of Legion of Boom. So on limited targets, like, Tyler Lockett is going to ball out. And I honestly still think he's the one there. I don't think DK Metcalf's going to take over yet, even though he is a baller. On the flip side, you got McLaurin. He's going to have all the volume. Okay. There is nobody else there other than Steven Sims Jr. Who's great as, like, a, you know, slot receiver, but in terms of, like, the targets, like, he is everything, but he's catching targets from Dwayne Haskins. You know, we like Dwayne Haskins. We think he's going to recover a little bit. But at the end of the day, it's the Washington Redskins football team. Fucking dumpster status, okay? They are not going to be in scoring opportunities very often. They're not going to be passing deep very often because their O-line is trash, and he's not going to have the time to do it, and he does not have the mobility to do it, and he does not have the accuracy to do it. So you basically have this dichotomy of, like, really more limited target volume, but highly efficient, really valuable targets because they're deep and they're into the red zone versus super high volume, but, like, probably very low quality. So that's why I think this is a really interesting dichotomy for me. And for me, I think I'm going to be going with Tyler Lockett.
Damn, Mike, we're never going to disagree.
Okay. I thought you were going to go with Terry McLaurin. And look, we all love Terry McLaurin, right? And maybe in PPR formats, maybe you can make like that adjustment for Terry McLaurin. And don't get me wrong, he's a baller. But I think what I saw from Tyler Lockett last year, he's clearly established himself as, like, that Doug Baldwin type guy, right? And Doug Baldwin was a top wide receiver. And with Russell Wilson, with that efficiency, I think Tyler Lockett could easily be a wide receiver one this year with, like, top eight upside. So I'm betting on the QB wide receiver combo because I think in terms of wide receiver, they're pretty close, right? They're pretty close in terms of, like, what they're able to do on the field. Tyler Lockett and McLaurin are both, you know, reception favorites from your boy Matt Harmon. So when it comes that close, I'm going to give the edge to the guy that's playing on the better offense with the better quarterback with the higher quality targets.
Yeah, the thing about it is, like, Tyler Lockett heading into last season, we were all kind of wary because he had one of the most efficient seasons of all time, which is fair, right? We're wary about A.J. Brown. We're wary about a bunch of guys that produced on extreme efficiency and limited volume. And then Tyler Lockett went out, had limited volume again, and still proved to be a very, very good fantasy receiver. And looking at his numbers prior to that calf injury, which I believe he sustained against San Francisco in that overtime game, I just remember it because he was on my team and he wasn't playing in overtime. Like, what the fuck is going on? And then Chase McLaughlin, like, sunk a field goal, so I was real pumped. His pace up until that point was 122 targets, which isn't, like, anything crazy, but 99 receptions, 1,269 yards, and 10 touchdowns. He's somebody that doesn't need 150, 160, 170 targets to be a legitimate wide receiver one because the quality of targets, as you said, are just – they're beautiful. They're accurate, and they're in high-value situations. He led the league in red zone targets last year with 23, and he was 12th in the NFL with 26 deep targets. So He's picking up chunk yardage. He's picking up – well, he's scoring a lot of touchdowns because he's being peppered in the red zone with one of the most accurate and one of the best quarterbacks in the entire NFL. That duo, it's like peanut butter and jelly. It's like Justin Herbert and Keenan Allen. It's a dynamic duo for the ages. And on the other side, as you already said, like, I do like Terry McLaurin, but it's really hard to put him ahead of a guy that is at this point been a perennial back-end wide receiver one when he's catching passes from Dwayne Haskins and maybe even Alex Smith at this point. Like, they're all out of answers. They want to throw whoever they can get out there behind center. I do think he's somebody that can definitely see 130 to 140 targets this year because he is the only mouth worth feeding in that Washington offense. But give me 110 to 120 targets in the Seattle-led offense from Russell Wilson, over 130 targets, albeit in the NFC East, but coming from Dwayne Haskins in an offense that we've seen be extremely inefficient. And I'm not so sure that Ron Rivera taking over the head coaching job there is going to change that too much. So I don't think either of these guys, I know it's a cop-out, like, I don't think either of them is of bad value, but I do think Tyler Lockett still gets a stigma of being overvalued and not having as high of upside as many other players because he doesn't get the target volume. Despite us seeing 2 years in a row, he doesn't need a ton of targets to produce with the likes of like an Amari Cooper, a Kenny Galladay, and all those bigger names that you'd pick like two or three rounds ahead of them.
Yep, definitely. Just another reason why you can't go wide receiver early. Again, the dude, like, zero RB zombies are out there defending that shit like it's their last breath, and just don't fall for it. Please don't fall for it, because in redraft, like, look, I get it. The argument is, like, you know, RBs are fragile and, you know, they might get hurt and whatever. But at the end of the day, like, you need to assume you can hit on those running backs to win, because those are the running backs that are on championship teams. So you can't play scared being like, oh, I don't want to draft CMC. I don't want to draft Mixon. I don't want to draft Josh Jacobs because they might get hurt. That's not how you play fantasy. We play to fucking win. If you're a coward, and you're scared of injured players getting hurt, look, I mean, you're cool with being third place. You're cool with being second place, aka first loser. Cool, go for it, man. That if that's your thing, if you just want to squeeze into the playoffs and hope that you get there every year, like, and be like, hey, I make the playoffs every year, like, cool, good for you. Go for that route. But if you're a big dog and you want to fucking win, right? Like, you only care about number one. That's all you care about. And to be number one, you got to hit on workhorse running backs. So even though they might bust, even though they have a higher bust rate, it doesn't matter, because you're trying to hit on that rate, and you're assuming you hit there, and then getting wide receiver values like Tyler Lockett, like Terry McLaurin, like some of these other guys are going to pop off to help you win that championship. But like, the wins over replacement for wide receivers is like basically non-existent, and like, there aren't many unicorn seasons like Michael Thomas. So you got to hit on the workhorse running backs and then fill your roster with guys like Lockett and Terry McLaurin. So next up, some more wide receivers to help you. Truly undervalued. I mean, the first guy, Tyler Boyd, going at 96th overall, wide receiver 32, versus the perennially underrated Jarvis Landry, going at 98th overall at wide receiver 33. So again, you got an interesting dichotomy here. Both offenses trying to make a comeback, trying to be on the rebound. But you got the young rising star in Tyler Boyd and the shockingly consistent Jarvis Landry. And this is actually like a tough one. I mean, when I saw this on here, and for me, I'm going to go with Tyler Boyd. Because that's my man, and I've been a big fan of Tyler Boyd like the entire time. Like, he's an analytical like darling, and he's kind of progressed exactly as we wanted him to progress. And now we're getting AJ Green back, which people might see as a negative, which I don't, because I just think it makes your team better. They obviously have Joe Burrow, and we saw how Joe Burrow targeted the slot and used Justin Jefferson, and I'm basically copy and pasting that usage onto Tyler Boyd. And I think that's what it's going to be like. And AJ Green's going to play on the outside. Tyler Boyd's going to play primarily out of the slot as more like a flanker even. And then you're going to have like John Ross and T. Higgins subbing in on the other side in three wide receiver sets. And I think that slot role is going to eat. He's not going to score a lot of touchdowns. So his ceiling of like a top five wide receiver is like probably non-existent, but he is going to give you that consistent wide receiver two production, in my opinion. So you're just gonna be able to comfortably slot him in there, because let's be honest, the Bengals aren't going to be very good. So they're going to be passing a lot, but they're not going to be scoring a lot. So I love Tyler Boyd. I get Jarvis Landry is always underrated, but he also had surgery in the offseason. Like, I don't even know how he's going to be for the beginning of the year. So a lot of question marks on that front. And I think the Bengals passing volume is going to be a lot higher than the Browns. So that's kind of like the scale tipper for me.
Yeah, both of these guys, their upside is tied directly to their volume. Neither one is extremely efficient. We saw all those years, Jarvis Landry, Miami, catching about 100 passes for 900 yards. Completely disgusting. Basically, Michael Thomas light. And it's kind of a similar situation now in Cleveland. They do bring in Austin Hooper, which is another mouth to feed, which we already brought up. And I've said mouth to feed way too often. You can tell I'm getting hungry right now. And on top of that, right, they bring in Kevin Stefanski. And you said that they want to have a revamped offense this season. I'm not so sure that their offense becoming better and progressing this season is going to in turn help Jarvis Landry's volume, because they do bring in Austin Hooper, a full season of Kareem Hunt. And if you look at Kareem Hunt's, or if you look at Jarvis Landry's splits with and without Kareem Hunt, he was actually much better with Kareem Hunt on the field. But I think that's also because the offense as a whole got better with Kareem Hunt back in the fold, and just how poorly they started off last season. So I wouldn't look too deep into that. I just think that if you're looking to draft one of these guys, you want the upside that is tied to their volume. And as you said, all they have there really is Joe Mixon out of the backfield, who is never going to catch 50 passes in the season because that just seems like a fever dream at this point. AJ Green coming off of a pretty serious foot injury that's held him out for basically 1.5 seasons. And T. Higgins, who you can argue is raw, you can argue is polished. Whatever the case may be, I don't see him pushing Tyler Boyd for the wide receiver 2 job there. And all Tyler Boyd has done is be productive these past 2 seasons. And all we have done in the fantasy community is disrespect this guy. He had like the 7th most targets last year. And I'm not saying that's going to happen again, but in an offense with an actual quarterback that isn't like Ryan Finley, Jeff Driscoll, Andy Dalton, all those guys are complete idiots and assholes when you compare them to Joe Burrow, who just had one of the best collegiate seasons of all time, who peppered the slot very heavily, and now is paired with an offensive mind in Zachary Taylor, who peppered the slot not only in Cincinnati, but he did the same with the Rams when he had Cooper Kupp. And that's basically what Tyler Boyd is. He's Cooper Kupp without the touchdown upside. And sure, that may not ever lead him to be a wide receiver 1 in the NFL for fantasy purposes, but he's finished as the wide receiver 21 and the wide receiver 16. And I see no reason for him to stray away from that path. You can argue that AJ Green being there is going to hurt his volume and his upside. But we look back to 2018 when he was catching passes from Driscoll and Andy Dalton in a completely like a season that went to shambles. The 9 games with AJ Green on the field, his 16-game pace was 98 receptions, 1,275 yards, 9 touchdowns, and was the wide receiver 12 over that span in the games where AJ Green played. So he still has the upside when he has an alpha wide receiver helping him on the outside, taking away a little bit of pressure off of him. And as opposed to Jarvis Landry, who has always been a target hog, but at this point of his career, especially coming off the injury with Odell hopefully bouncing back from his injury, bringing Austin Hooper and having a bunch of other mouths to feed in that offense, I'm just not sure, so sure that his volume is as guaranteed as Tyler Boyd's. And in turn, playing in a similar division or in the same division, I'm not so sure that he's going to be able to outproduce Tyler Boyd, who looks to see another season of 130 plus targets.
Yep, for sure. Okay, so a little bit more there. Let's see if we can agree on this next one or not. I know it's going to hit near and dear to your heart here, so bear with me. But we got some tight ends coming up, and I know no one cares about tight ends, but believe it or not, they do matter, and they are on your team. So we got to talk about them. So we got Hayden Hurst, probably like one of the most hyped offseason tight ends that I've ever come across. He's going to pick 92, a tight end 8. At tight end 8, just wrap your head around that for 1 second. And then you got Hunter Henry at tight end 9 at pick 94, so 2 picks behind him. So, again, it's another interesting dichotomy, right? Like Hayden Hurst is going into a high-volume pass offense with a quarterback that, you know, throws a shitload. Like, I would not be shocked at all if Matt Ryan throws for like 600-plus attempts again this year. So, definitely a lot of opportunity there for him to grab if he is good. And then you got Hunter Henry. A lot of question marks, right? You're going to start with Ty God, Taylor, right? And then we don't know when his backup tight end, Justin Herbert, is going to come in.
Hi, but Mike. Mike, it's getting late, but I'm still aware of what you're saying about my man.
We don't know when Justin Herbert's coming in. So, obviously, cap ceiling on the volume side. You got Keenan Allen. You got Mike Williams there. You got Austin Eckler. So, a lot of guys vying for targets. We don't know how good that – but more importantly, we don't know how good that offense is going to be. Like, I wouldn't be worried about the how many mouths feed thing because I think that's stupid, but we just don't know like how good that offense will be and how much passing volume there will be for all of them to even fight over. So a lot of risks on both sides. Who are you going with? I'm gonna pass it off you this one first. I want to hear your thoughts.
All right, I can kind of tell. Actually, I don't know. I think you're gonna go Hayden Hurst. I'm going Hunter Henry on this one because to me it's like talent versus opportunity, and you always say it, Mike. Talent or targets are earned, not given. Hayden Hurst these past 2 seasons has been in Baltimore. Can you name me more than 2 receivers that have caught a pass in Baltimore other than Mark Andrews? It's like Hollywood Brown and Chris Moore, or like a bunch of frauds like Seth Roberts. Why couldn't he carve out a role there? Is it because he's not good at football? The answer to that question is yes. He can log more miles an hour on his changeup than total receptions he has in his career, and probably targets he's had to this point in his career as well. And sure, they gave him the bag, and they want him to be Austin Hooper 2.0 or Tony Gonzalez 2.0. But me personally, I don't see it. I don't see him just going into Atlanta and seeing 100 targets off the rip. Why not just give the targets that Austin Hooper gave up, obviously give a few to Hayden Hurst, but why not give more to Julio Jones? Why not give more to Calvin Ridley? Why don't you give it to people that can actually play football and have proven to be good at football? And Hunter Henry, sure, he's not going to be the highest volume play you can ever get. But if there's one thing Tyrod Taylor could do in Buffalo, it's throw 2-yard slants to Charles Clay a million times a season. He averaged 79 targets a year for a three-year stretch. Obviously, that doesn't translate directly over because the surrounding weapons weren't Keenan Allen, Austin Eckler, Mike Williams, and all the other beasts that are making up the Chargers receiving group. But he did show that, and I think it's kind of intuitive, right? Like, you have a big body guy that gets open over the middle pretty quickly in Hunter Henry and Keenan Allen. He looks to be in line for a decent chunk of targets, and he's never really been the most volume-heavy play you can get the tight end position. He's only capped out at 76 targets, and that happened last season when he finished as the tight end 9. A lot of that was due to injury, but you know, the 79 targets that Charles Clay saw on average was more than what Hunter Henry has ever seen in a single season. So for me personally, if I'm investing in a tight end this late, if you want to go for the volume play, go for it. You're probably going to end up with like the tight end 7 on the season, which isn't great. I'll just go with Hunter Henry, who seems to be and has been a huge part of this red zone offense and hasn't needed a ton of volume in the past for him to produce.
Yeah. So I'm going to opt this by saying, first of all, I'm not going to invest in either one. So if I, similar to Melvin Gordon and Todd Gurley, I'm just not going to invest in tight ends in this range. But if I had to pick one, I'm with you on Hunter Henry, because I do believe, like I said, targets are earned, not given. And I think people are projecting that Austin Hooper role onto Hayden Hurst. And I think people think like Austin Hooper's a bum. Like, I don't actually think Austin Hooper's a bum.
I thought he was a bum for a long time until I looked into the numbers. He's actually pretty good after the catch. He's what we think Vance McDonald is.
Yeah, like, I mean, look, he got a lot of volume. It's a high volume pass offense, but he still had to like earn those targets, man. He's competing against Julio Jones, the greatest receiver of this generation. And like Calvin Ridley, who's an up and coming like wide receiver. They got Russell Gage over there. So he was like definitely the third best target, maybe the second best target, and someone that Ryan felt comfortable passing to. And look, like, wide receivers when they transition have a huge learning curve, right? And we know tight ends have a huge learning curve to just be in the NFL period. So for the fact for him to like transfer teams like in his like second year, it's a little bit worrisome for me personally. Like, I just don't see him making that jump. And like, I don't believe vacated targets is a thing. I'm sure he'll get some volume, but I just don't see him returning the tight end 8 price at all. And I don't think he has top 5 upside. And if I'm shooting for later on tight ends, which we'll get into a little bit later, I want like top 5 upside. And I just don't think Hayden Hurst has it. And I think people are just projecting too much volume onto it. Whereas like, if I had to pick, I would choose Hunter Henry, because on a points per game basis, like, he was actually there. Like, when he came back, Hunter Henry was actually winning you weeks. And granted, it was with Philip Rivers, and we have a lot of risks around, like, you know, Tygod and Herbert, but arguably like tight, big body tight ends are like a pretty comfortable target for quarterbacks that like can't really push it deep and just aren't that good in that field. And like you said, Tygod made like Charles Clay pretty viable, and Hunter Henry is way, way, way better
Thank you. I needed some Chargers hype. I needed somebody to say that Hunter Henry is better than Charles Clay. I needed some positive news, and that wasn't coming from Roto World.
Yeah. So, I mean, look, if I had to pick, I'm picking Hunter Henry, but I think there's some better options later on, which we'll get into right now. Next up, true late round tight end target. We got TJ Hockenson going at 107 as the tight end 12 versus Jared Cook at 112, at pick 112 as the tight end 13. And this is another interesting dichotomy. It's youth versus age. You know, Jared Cook coming off a monster year with Drew Brees, as putting up a top 8 performance, and it was actually pretty usable on a points per game basis, mostly coming off of like massive, like broken plays where he like basically just went for like 50-yard catches and a touchdown. Not too sustainable. Like, that entire passing offense, the TD efficiency that Drew Brees and Jared Cook had was not very sustainable. And honestly, is one of the reasons why I'm kind of fading that passing game this year, with the exception of Michael Thomas and Alvin Kamara, obviously. But I'm going to go with Hockenson here, and Hockenson's my guy for late round targets. And look, one thing I can't stand is like it right now, I get it. It's like off season, people are bored, but like everyone is just like throwing out like fucking 10 darts on like tight ends, being like, yeah, I like Mike Gesicki, I like John O. Smith, I like Dallas Goedert, I like TJ Hockenson, I like Noah Fant. And like every week someone will like put out a new freaking thread on like one of these late round tight ends that have like top five upside. It's like, dude, stop being fucking cowards, man. Just pick one guy and go with it. And look, it's a tough space to beat because every year there's only one of them. So no one's gonna blame you if you're wrong. But like you can't take fucking victory laps when you like throw out five darts and one of them hits. Like a 20% hit rate is nothing to brag about. So I urge all of you guys out there that are like, you can draft a bunch of them. Like, don't get me wrong, but please don't go on Twitter just spam clicking like late round tight end targets. Like nobody cares. Nobody cares about, and then coming back and you pull the receipt from like August being like, oh, see, I told you Mike Gesicki was gonna hit. Like, first of all, no, Mike Gesicki's trash. He's not gonna hit. Like that's a given. But second of all, just have some guts, man. Have some guts. Like, plant your flag on someone. I'm planting my flag on TJ Hockenson. He was an elite prospect coming in. I was a huge fan of him. And, you know, he obviously blew up first week against, you know, one of the worst tight end teams in the league in Arizona. But as a rookie, still, like, nonetheless, very impressive. And obviously, he fell off. He had a bunch of injuries. And then Stafford got injured as well. So things didn't go well for him. But, like, in terms of his progression, like I kind of saw a lot of like what I want to see. You know, he had some drop issues in the red zone, which kind of held him back a little bit. But he has the profile, he has the athleticism, he has the draft capital, and there is space in that offense for him. Like there is definitely enough passing volume to go around to support both a Kenny Golladay, a Marvin Jones, and a TJ Hockenson. And we know Marvin Jones has not been the cleanest bill of health. So should he kind of back away there, like you're going to get some more opportunities for TJ Hockenson. They added DeAndre Swift. I like where that offense is going. Again, it's Matt Patricia, so I'm always a little bit hesitant, but if I had to pick a late round tight end in that like tight end like 12 to like 15 range, I'm putting my stamp on TJ Hockenson. I think he's as good a bet as any, and he is my horse that I'm choosing to go forward with. So I'm picking TJ Hockenson as my breakout tight end of the year.
Mike, how many more targets do you think Jared Cook had than TJ Hockenson last season?
Not many, like maybe like 10, 15.
He had six more targets than Hockenson. Hockenson played 12 games. Jared Cook played 14. You have to keep in mind they add Emmanuel Sanders. Alvin Kamara comes back healthy, who occupies a similar part of the field as Jared Cook. Jared Cook's a little bit deeper down the field, but then Emmanuel Sanders eats into that work. I just don't see any chance his volume increases. And on the limited volume he had, he was extremely, extremely touchdown heavy. And that's not the right word. He was extremely dependent on his touchdowns, and I think that's a rate that he put up last year that isn't something he can match. He had like 9 touchdowns on 50 receptions. I don't think that's sustainable at all, especially for Jared Cook, who's never really been a big touchdown scorer throughout his entire career. He basically made his hay in the past off of being like the wide receiver one in Oakland because they had nothing left and Amari Cooper just didn't want to play for them anymore. Whereas TJ Hockenson is a little bit more of a black box type of player because we didn't see much out of him last season. But they did give him 59 targets, and he was playing a big portion of the snaps heading into the season, 71 and 78% of the snaps to start the year. And even towards the end of the season, his last game he played in, he was given 11 targets. And sure, they were kind of banged up towards the end of the season, and they were relying on younger players like him to produce. But I believe in the talent there. I do think that the volume he's going to see is going to outclass what Jared Cook is in line for. And maybe, and most likely, the New Orleans Saints offense is going to be more in scoring opportunities than the Detroit Lions are. But Jared Cook not being a huge red zone target for that team and scoring a lot of touchdowns, as you said, off of broken plays, I believe only 5 out of his 9 touchdowns came from inside the 20, which isn't even really saying much because a 20-yard touchdown is fluky as well. I believe that TJ Hockenson has as good a chance as any to match Jared Cook's touchdown number, and I think that his volume is going to outclass Jared Cook's as well because we have seen that this offense can produce more than one fantasy-relevant player. We've seen Golladay, Golden Tate, and Marvin Jones produce in one season as well. And sure, maybe DeAndre Swift does eat into his work a little bit out of the backfield, but Kerryon Johnson was being used out of the backfield a little bit as well last season. So I'm going to stick with you, Mike. I like the talent in TJ Hockenson. I don't think you start out your rookie season, your first game ever, as hot as he did and like not be good at football. I think they're going to find a way to get him the ball in the red zone and deep down the field as well, because he is a mismatch for linebackers with the size and speed that he presents. And heading into the NFL, he was seen as a much better prospect and a better player than Noah Fant, who everybody seems to love right now. So I don't get the TJ Hockenson hate. It always takes tight ends a little bit for them to produce. And the fact that he did produce early on, albeit not consistently, leads me to believe that heading into the season, they want him to be a big part of this offense.
Yeah, I mean, this guy had 7 red zone targets last year. And like you said, he was hurt and he had a couple of drops. So for me, it's important to me to see that tight end is getting those high leverage scenario opportunities. And going into second year, like, people are always way too early on tight ends. You got to wait. Like, you got to be patient. And a prospect like this that puts up a performance, I don't care if it was against the worst team in the league. Like, you do not put up a performance like that if you're a bum. And I'm just going to bet on the talent here. You know, we kind of did the evaluation like last year, and he was someone I love. He's someone Nick loved. I don't know how high you were on him, but I was super high on him, and I still am. So I'm continuing the Hockenson train. I think people have kind of, like, you know, forgotten about him, but I think he's definitely there to ball out again this year. So if you're going to pick a late round target, I'm picking TJ Hockenson. Good luck to all you guys out there that pick other ones. You know, we'll see what happens. But again, just have some balls, man. Just pick one and go with it.
Yeah, choose Justin Herbert. He's the best late round tight end.
Yeah, best late round target of possible. All right, so that kind of wraps it up this week for the ADP battles. You know, hopefully you guys found it helpful, especially those of you that are redraft. Hopefully you guys can come and play some Dynasty. Next week we'll be incorporating and going back and incorporating some more Dynasty content as well. But definitely wanted to make sure we hit both audiences. Yeah, so make sure you cop the draft guide if you haven't already. You know, we got the redraft in there. We got the Dynasty in there. We got the ADP. We got the ranks. Like, literally everything you need to dominate your goddamn drafts, it's in there. I promise you, you will enjoy every second of it. Make sure you sign up for the Discord. Leagues are still going up, both Dynasty and redraft. Noah is slaving away to get these leagues up and running for you guys, and it's going to be a lot of fun. Redraft, obviously, no commitment past the year one. And then Dynasty, you better stick around unless you're weak. So it's going to be a lot of fun. Make sure you join up all those things. Become a Patreon, subscribe, follow me at Mike Me Up 2Ps, follow Noah at FB God, follow Nick, follow our accounts. Make sure you subscribe. Give us that thumbs up because it really helps us in the long run. And again, really appreciate all you guys tuning in. Like, you know, Noah and I are just starting. We're literally just starting, and we're going to continue pumping out a lot of content for you guys. So make sure you tune in for all the video content's coming your way this week, next week, and every single goddamn week after that.